choppy little show. It's gonna be a choppy little show. I see my brother Ali Bay coming to the building. It's gonna be a choppy little show. But what I wanna do is I wanna see where the people are at. So I'm just gonna look at the chat real quick. I see my brother still in there with the black power. Well, yeah, I seen the Sankofa. Sankofa reaching, boss. Boss, he reaching, man. Let him keep reaching, man. You can't touch me, man. It is what it is, man. But I'll be right back at you. You know what I'm saying? Sankofa reaching. Man, look, these guys are so thirsty. You know, they hungry. They falling off. They falling off slowly but surely. And so they trying to hold on to whatever they can hold on to. But let them keep trying, man. That's all right, man. It's all good, man. You know what I mean? I ain't do Sankofa wrong. Sankofa did itself wrong. Sankofa chose to walk around and sell tickets and try to sell drinks and then wear a patch on his arm. You know what I mean? He did that. Sankofa did that. Sankofa walked around talking to somebody, telling somebody he got, do he want to buy some white girl? I didn't film that. I didn't do that. That's Sankofa fault, man. Live your life right and can't nobody expose you. Period, point blank. You know what I mean? Them guys get exposed because they ain't living right. Anyway, I got my brother Ali in the building. Real quick, Ali, how you doing, my brother? Islam, Ali.
Islam, bro, what's going on?
Islam. What we're going to do is we're going to keep it straight to the point until the brothers come in. Basically, we're talking about the subject, white mean purity, purity mean God, and God mean ruler of the land. And we're saying, what does white really mean? You know, because people outside of the Moore Science Temple of America, or outside the teachers of the Moore Science Temple of America, they'll tell you quick, man, y'all guys like them Europeans, but you know, quote unquote, y'all guys like them white people, quote unquote, y'all, all of those nonsense, because they ain't even reading the science. They ain't reading the science. So, brother, according to you, on the basic level, when you read something like white mean purity, purity mean God, and God means ruler of the land, what does white mean to you?
Well, I mean, white is, it depends on what you're talking about. If we're talking in the social sense, white is being used primarily as an identification. And it was a group, it's being used as a group identification at this point in time for all people of European descent with pale skin. That wasn't always the case. I don't know if you can hear me clear or not.
Yes, I can hear you very clear.
Yeah, but that wasn't always the case in colonial America. When you look into the colonial history here in the United States, initially, when they came up with the white construct, it was reserved for European males, for the most part, European males who owned property and were over a certain age. I believe it was over 21 or something like that. And these elite people, the ones that own property, meaning land, slaves, servants, whether they be apprentices or what have you, these European males were the ones who would be considered white. And they were really people of British descent for the most part, because all the other Europeans were not included in that in the beginning. So in that sense, from a social perspective, it's being used as an identity that started off with European males of English or British descent, and it grew as labor issues came into play between the so-called blacks and the so-called whites. As labor issues began to arise, this particular identification grew because the poorer Europeans would side with the blacks when it came to labor issues and so forth. And as the elites began to see what was happening, they started grouping even the poor Europeans into this white classification, in order to create the division between the so-called poor whites or the poor Europeans and the Asiatic laborers, or what our people would say African or black laborers, what have you. And so basically it's being used at this point in time as a social identification. Whether or not it means purity depends on the culture that you're looking at. Now, there are many, there are different cultures that see whiteness as representative of purity. During the debate that Brother Way L had with Ali Muhammad, one of the things that he did bring up was in the Yoruba tradition, how whiteness is seen as a form of purity, is a representative of purity. Even in the debate that Brother Sharif had with Reggie, he brought up a piece from an Egyptologist named Dr. Graciela Gustoso Singer, where she covered color in ancient Egypt. And this is, let me just read to you what this particular Egyptologist had to say about the color white. She says, white in ancient Egypt, the color white, which, you know, you pronounce it hedge or shesep, suggested omnipotence and purity. This is in line with what our prophet says, white means purity. But she's saying in ancient Egypt, the color white suggested omnipotence and purity. The name of the city of Memphis meant white walls. During religious ceremonies, were worn white sandals, and white bowls were used for libations. In the instructions of Merikari, the expression, quote unquote, wearing white sandals is used to describe being a priest. She's citing Lichtenstein in 1973 piece by this person. And then she goes on and says, in Memphis, even the embalming table for the Apis bulls was made of white alabaster. The god Nefertin, whose symbol was the white lotus flower, often had his statues made of silver to illustrate his link with the color white. Many of the sacred objects were made from white alabaster. Many of the sacred objects were made from white alabaster. And many of the sacred animals, such as oxen, cows, and hippopotami, were also white. She's citing Rakim in 2006 piece. White was also the heraldic color of Upper Egypt. He said it again, white was also the heraldic color of Upper Egypt. The crown of Upper Egypt was white, Nefer Hejit. Even though originally it was probably made of green reeds, she says, citing Urk. In Egyptian art, the pure white color was created from chalk and gypsum. White as opposed to the natural off-white and freshly laundered clothes were the attire anybody wore who could afford it, which even fewer could in times of chaos. And she's citing someone else. So the bottom line is, what she was pointing out is the color white. And we're not talking about white people. This has absolutely nothing to do with ethnicity. This has absolutely nothing to do with race. It has absolutely nothing to do with one's national origin or descent. We're merely talking about colors based upon what the eye sees and what colors symbolize to certain people. And in ancient Egypt, what she's saying is this particular color, white, did in fact suggest omnipotence and purity. So with that, we go further. In ancient and modern Britons, the book by David McRitchie. And let me just give this piece again so people can maybe look it up if they're looking for it. This is a piece called Color in Ancient Egypt by Dr. Graciela Gustoso Singer. Graciela Gustoso Singer. And let's see something here. I just want to say something. Yeah, so that piece is online. You can actually look that up. Ancient and Modern Britons by David McRitchie. He speaks about the use of color classifications in Europe. This is long before the transatlantic slave trade or anything of that nature. And he talks about how white and black were used among pale-skinned Europeans to signify social classifications, where you fit in the particular society. So a pale-skinned person could be labeled a black person depending on his social or economic standing in society and in Europe, in ancient Europe. So you can look that up. This is in the book Ancient and Modern Britons, and Britons, but you have to forgive me because I don't have all of the things that I wanted to present here with me. But just from the top of my head, I know that's one source that people can go to. Read Ancient and Modern Britons by David McRitchie. This is a European man speaking about how color was seen and used in Europe by pale-skinned Europeans on each other. So certain pale-skinned people could be classified as blacks if they fell within a certain economic or social status within that society. I have something else for you too. Let's go here. Different pieces from different sources that I compiled. And this is in the Ali's Men group. So there's a lot of stuff for people who are interested in a lot of this information. If you join the Ali's Men group, you will see in our file section, there's a lot of information in there. And this is just one piece that I pulled. It's some commentary on black and white as documented at various points in history. I'm not trying to deal so much with the black piece, but it's hard to not deal with them because they contrast, and it's hard to not deal with one without dealing with the other. But the focus is really the white thing. But the bottom line is, I think what we're trying to get at is whether or not it represented purity. Yes, in different cultures, it does represent purity. It's not just Egypt. It's not just with the Yoruba. There are other cultures where whiteness does represent purity, but that has nothing to do with someone's skin color. It has nothing to do with someone's ethnicity or their so-called race or what have you. This is just the way people from ancient times have viewed the colors based on their customs and their culture. So let me read a couple of pieces. I have a piece from a quote from a piece called Free Blacks of Lynchburg. And this is very interesting because we can go into the invention of the white race and so forth. But before we get there, let me just read this. This piece is called Free Blacks of Lynchburg, Virginia, 1805 through 1865 is when this piece was put out. Page 14, it says here, another important concern is that those people labeled as black or colored in the documentary record were often as much Indian or European as African and may not have had any African ancestry at all. There should be no misunderstanding, though, that the contemporary division of Southern society into white and black races was for the most part arbitrary and subjective. Now, that's very interesting, because what they're talking about is that even in Southern society in what became the United States, that the division between white and black was arbitrary and subjective, and that people who were labeled as black or colored in the documentary records were often as much Indian or European as they were African. And some of them may not have had any African ancestry at all, but still were labeled black. So that just goes to show you, in terms of a social classification, how arbitrary, how racist, and how subjective this thing really is, and is based upon the will, the pure will of elite European males, these particular labels. And part of the reason that they took the label white is not so much because of their skin color, it's because of what it actually represented, not just to them, but to other ancient cultures as well. Theodore W. Allen says in his piece, Invention of the White Race, he says that whiteness is not a race, that whiteness is a status or a classification in society that anybody can hold at any point in time. Anybody. It just depends on who is in charge of doing the classifications. So in this particular instance, European males were in charge of classifying people. So they took white and they assigned black and Negro and so forth to other people. You see what I'm saying? So, but like I said, it has a lot to do with the fact that they knew that whiteness does represent purity. And you know that they knew this because they put it in their dictionary. So when you go and look into their dictionaries and you see the definition of purity next to white, you know that they understood that particular concept. Omnipotence, purity, etc. And like I just told you, this particular this particular Egyptologist had come to the same conclusion about the ancient Egyptians. But I'm running low. I'm running low on battery power on my laptop. But what you wanted to say, Brother Tahaka?
Oh no, I wanted to say that I think you did a beautiful job in speaking on that. Who just came in the chat room? Who is that right there? Raheem, who was that?
I think that's Grimmy RL.
Oh, that's Grimmy RL. Okay, Islam. But brother, if your laptop die out, no problem. But I think you did a beautiful job touching on that. But let me say something. When I remember one time, right, back in the day, right, and back in the day, long, long, long time ago, when I came into the Moore Science Temple of America, right, matter of fact, let me turn my camera on. When I came to be a part of the Moore Science Temple of America, and I first heard that term, white mean purity, purity mean God, and God mean ruler of the land, it was explained to me in such a way that was so eloquent that I couldn't take it the wrong way. So nowadays, it seems like people are not being explained how this science of Moore science is relevant today as it relates to using the term white and using the term black. Now, look at this. Let's take basic information. For instance, we know that European calls themselves white. We know it for a fact. We know that they call us black. We didn't give ourselves that name, no matter what you say black means, no matter what it means to you. We did not name ourselves. Europeans did it. And they named themselves white because white, in contrast to black, is supposed to be good. White, black is supposed to be bad. Bottom line. But now listen to this. The prophet Noble Drew Ali says, white mean purity, purity mean God, and God means ruler of the land. Let's take that last part. Me and the Grand Sheik from my temple, we rode up here from Baltimore. Now, to get to Chi-Town from Baltimore, we can't get here if we don't pay no tolls. I didn't put them tolls there.
Exactly.
White mean purity, purity mean God. Now, we're not talking about no almighty God. White mean purity, purity mean God, God mean rulers of the land. Who is ruling this land right now? You can't go nowhere without paying no toll. You can't go to New York from Baltimore. From New York to Philly. From Baltimore to Philly without paying a toll. Who is ruling the land? They take the term white and identify themselves with it, sit themselves up high, give us the term black, and now we're gonna try to make a road doo-doo smell like rose.
Right.
Talking about it's the cosmos of the cosmology, and black is the essence of us. No, they took it and they put it in a social construct that if you use it, you become disenfranchised. And they take the term white. But I'm gonna let my brother Grimmy RL touch on it for a little bit, because I like to, when I touch on something, I'm looking at it from a point of view that it affected me today. I gotta pay some tolls. Because somebody is ruling this land. Right. Period.
Right.
And I'll let Grimmy RL touch on it from another point of view. Brother Grimmy RL, come on into the chat. How you doing, my brother?
Islam. Can you hear me, beloved?
Islam.
Yeah, beautiful, beautiful. Basically, Ali did a great job in breaking that down. I didn't start from the beginning of the show, so I apologize for being late. But, you know, with that being said, you know, more just like we did the show on blackness, you know, we basically now do the same thing in reverse. And, you know, we can go back to the prophet's literature in the article entitled "What Shall We Call Him?" And Prophet Noble Drew Ali basically broke down just exactly what you said, Brother Taharka, in that regard. Because basically, if you study this color-coded system, you know, like what Brother Sharif, you know, usually like to refer to it as, and that's exactly what it is. If you refer to this color-coded system, we all know that, and you'll hear a lot of the Afrocentric brothers and a lot of activists and things of that nature, you know, they'll always talk about they robbed us of our language, they robbed us of our culture, they robbed us of our name. And you know, when they doing the speeches and whatnot, you know, you'll hear them say those things. But you know, one thing that our brothers never really studied is that, yeah, they stripped all of that stuff, but what did they replace it with? And actually, what they did was they replaced it with absolutely nothing and put us in that color code system, whereas they said that they were Negroes, coloreds, and blacks, which didn't tie back into anything past slavery. So with that, they was able to cut us off from our divine ancestors. And the enslaver, if you will, or the European, they study high sciences. You know, they don't just do all the time things just arbitrarily, just because. Basically, they know what they're doing in that regard. So they know that if you can cut a man off from his lineage and his legacy, that goes against that scientific principle that's included in the scripture, that thou shall honor thy father and thy mother. You know, and that is not there just to say, oh, well, God say honor your father and your mother. There's a universal principle tied into that. And when they're talking about your father and your mother, they're not only talking about the man or the woman, and the woman, I should say, that gave birth to you. They are basically talking about your ancestral lineage. So obviously, as a universal scientific principle of karma, of retribution, and things of that nature, if you don't honor the mother and your father, or your divine lineage, if you will. So they knew that by disenfranchising us from those things, that they can keep us powerless. It's universal law and science included in a lot of these things. And that's what people have to understand. So when Noble Drew Ali, and this is basically the drawback of what we are saying, because it's rooted in truth. But when you get people that are operating solely on emotionalism, they say, well, look, those guys saying that they're not black. And, you know, they assuming that we are saying we're not black in the sense of denying our heritage. But that's not so, because all of the teachers of the Morris Science Temple of America are about going back to our ancient ancestral heritage, if you will. So we just saying that we are connecting back to something that ties us into a great history. Therefore, we call ourselves Moors, which is the last empire, if you will, of our people before the Great Fall.
Islam. So one brother is in the chat, and he's a man. You know what? I like this brother, True Colors. True Colors gonna be a Moor. We gonna get him a Fez. I'm in Chicago. They got Fezes up here. I'm gonna get that brother a Fez. But anyway, True Colors said, "Where is the science, brother?" Bring me on ill. I don't know if Ali Bey has left yet. If his battery died, but nevertheless,
I'm here.
Okay. Any one of you brothers, this brother want to know why Moore's science. Where is the science? He want to know what science is the Moors talking about. What science are we talking about? I can answer, but one of you brothers can answer that.
I'm gonna look in the chat. I would just say, I would say like this. We're talking about the sciences that everybody else is talking about. The same sciences. Like, in other words, nobody's trying to reinvent any wheel. Nobody's pulling things from out of the sky. You know, we're here in this world. This science at its root means knowledge. So when we're talking about knowledge, at the root of the word science is the word knowledge. When we're talking about the knowledge of the Moors, the knowledge of man, the knowledge of self, these are the things that we're talking about. The prophet says, if you ask me what to study, I would tell you self. Everybody in the conscious community now, after Noble Drew Ali taught about the knowledge of the self, everybody in the conscious community now, since then, has been concerned with the knowledge of the self, whether that's from a historical perspective, whether that is from a religious or spiritual perspective. But understand, science or knowledge is the same thing. We're talking about the same things that everybody else is talking about. We're just talking about it from the perspective of our ancient ancestors and the way they dealt with things. And so now, I just read to you from an Egyptologist, and this is a well-respected Egyptologist, even though the brother Shaka didn't want to accept what she was saying at the debate, because this was the same piece that Sharif read at the debate, and he got upset about it because he misunderstood it and thought that this was some kind of slight against someone's ethnicity or skin complexion or what have you. That's not what was being spoken about. What she's explaining from her work as an Egyptologist is that the ancient Egyptians, their knowledge and their understanding of these colors is the same as what Prophet Noble Drew Ali was talking about. So when she tells you in her work, based on her years of experience as an Egyptologist, an actual Egyptologist, not somebody who reads books of other Egyptologists, but someone who actually does this stuff. This woman works with the UNESCO and the whole nine. This is, you know, she's a legitimate Egyptologist. So when she's telling you, based on her work as an Egyptologist, a qualified Egyptologist, an actual doctor, not a high school dropout, an actual doctor. What she's telling you is that based on what she's come to gather from her works and probably peer reviewing other people's works, is that the color system, the way the Egyptians saw it, is the same as what the prophet is saying. When he said white means purity, one of the first things she said about whiteness is that white represented purity and omnipotence to the ancient Egyptians. That and like I said, we can pull that into West Africa with the Yorubas. The people in the Yoruba see, in the Yoruba tradition, they see whiteness as purity, representing purity. The problem is our people are so caught up on the Europeans' Western concept of what white represents. They think that when we talk about white, that we're talking about someone's skin. First of all, those people are not white people. Those people, if you look at them, their skin is pale and it's some kind of pink to tan. It's some kind of pink to tan. Like, we got to be honest about this.
That's right.
All right, the same way we keep saying we're not black, because most of us in the United States have some varying degree of brown skin. Those pale skin, pink, red to tan people are not white. That is a classification that they constructed here for the purpose of putting themselves on a pedestal above everybody else. Has nothing to do with their skin color.
And you know,
other than the fact that people with that skin color occupy that particular status in society. But it's not a description of the skin color. It's merely a social classification.
That's right.
You know the sad part about this, Ali Bey, the sad part about this, I don't know if you've seen that video with my son on Facebook. My son is 6 years old, and he had that black Tomcat. And it's a part in that video. I don't know if you've seen it. If you haven't seen it, go to my page to check it out. And I didn't coerce my son. I said, teach me something today. What can you teach us? And I just turned my phone on. But anyway, in that video, he goes to and say, and my cat, this mm-hmm. cat is black. My arm mm-hmm. is brown. It can't right. fit into my arm. I said, now, what do you mean fit?
Right.
I said, what do you mean? This is a six-year-old now.
But young kids can see that until they get corrupted by by the social ideologies of the adults.
And I asked them, absolutely. I asked them, Ali. I said, what do you mean fit into your arm? And at 6 years old, he used the word camouflage. It doesn't camouflage into my arm.
Now, let's do this. Let's do a simple experiment. What's the brother's name in the chat that you said was asking about the science and so forth?
That's probably True Colors. True Colors. Brother, that's my man. He's going to be my man. He's been an antagonist, but he's going to be my man. He's going to be my student.
It's all right. I mean, a lot of people are going to be antagonists, but to me, the antagonism is a symbol of either a lack of understanding or some kind of a block that is not allowing them to see, for whatever reason, is not allowing them to see something that's really plain to see. So here's the thing, right? I had a conversation with a five percent brother a few years back, where he was trying to talk about, you know, he was making the point about the white man and the black man and, you know, whatever it is that it was being said at the time. And he was bothered by the fact that we say that we're not black. And so I said, well, here's a little experiment, bro. I said, when you see a beautiful sister walking down the street, and you say, oh man, if I was on the phone with you and you was telling me, oh man, you should see this. Oh my, she's bad. Oh my God, I wish you could see it. And I said, describe her. How you would wind up describing her? Oh, she's about 5'4". She got this kind of build. She brown skin. You know what I'm saying? She brown skin. You know what I'm saying? This people describe people by, when they're talking skin complexion, they describe people by their skin complexion. And usually they'll say brown skin, light skin, she yellow, she red bone, this, that, and they'll say these things, but nobody, until they're talking from a racial perspective, or until they're talking from some kind of quote-unquote ethnicity perspective, nobody describes another person as black skin. Oh, I'm looking at this bad chick. Yo, she black skin. She's this. No, you're going to say she's brown skin. And if you was to paint somebody on a canvas, like the brother True Colors, if he was to paint himself on a canvas, guarantee you he's going to use some shade of brown to be true to his color. Since we're dealing with True Colors, to be true to his color, he's going to use some shade of brown to depict himself accurately on the canvas. Same will go for his entire family. He's going to use some shade of brown. So don't get upset when we're talking about we're not black, because you're not black either. You know it. Everybody knows it, regardless of how much they want to fight against what we're saying. They know that they're not black, but they're black in culture. They're black socially. You understand what I'm saying? Whatever that means. But to them, culturally, we're black because of our experience coming from slaves and blah, blah, blah. Now, 9 times out of 10, when you really get into the black identity, and I really didn't want to talk about the black identity, but when you get into that, it's going to always be based upon the slave trade, the system of chattel slavery here, oppression, you know, racist activities like Jim Crowism, you know what I'm saying? All of these things that go along with the black identity and the black culture and the black experience. You know, that's the things that people turn to. We are descendants of slaves, you know, and we're black because we're all, that's what makes them black. The things that I've heard from different people in terms of explanations as to what makes you black, they'll start going into those things, or they start getting philosophical. Now, like the brothers talking about science, they never use science to prove the blackness. They start getting philosophical. So it's like, oh, I'm black because outer space, you know, it's black out there in space. So, you know, that means that I'm black.
Or mother's womb.
Or the inside of the mother's womb is black. My thing is, well, if you're talking about because there's no light inside of there, the same thing goes for European women. The same thing goes for Asian women and any other kind of woman. There's no light up inside of anybody's womb. So the same will hold true. So everybody's black. So the logic is off. There is no science to support it. Like when the brother started to try to admonish Sharif at the debate, he was getting so much on my nerves. My thing was, yo, we don't need to listen to this dude talking this. I said, yo, Sharif, make this dude prove that he's black. They're always talking about science. Everybody's always worrying about science as if they're actual scientists themselves. None of these people are scientists, but they're worrying about science so much. So I'm like, okay, if he's supposed to be so concerned with science, make this dude use science to prove that he's actually a black person. Prove what black is using science. And then use science to prove that you are this thing called black. You know that dude shut up? He stopped talking. He stopped talking. Because the bottom line is when it comes down to it, they know that there's nothing that they can actually prove. That's why it has to become philosophical. It has to become philosophical. So in any case, I wanted to bring this up about science. Okay, because oftentimes they'll ask, well, what science are you using? I like to go to the nature sciences because this one, to me, fulfills what it is that they're looking for. They want to know what kind of science. So when you start talking political science or some other kind of philosophical science, they don't want to, they don't really accept that. So let's go to the nature sciences, the science of biology. All right. And when we're talking, when it is said that black means death according to science, again, let's look at the word means. And Sharif pointed this out, and I like to point this out to people, because one of the things about Noble Drew Ali is if you're not careful with what you read from his literature in terms of the context and how he was using the words to construct his sentences, you have to be very careful. Because you can get fooled by what he said if you're not careful with how he was using the words and what words he used. Like, for instance, you'll hear a lot of people say, the Moors say that black is death. No. The Moors that say black is death is misquoting Prophet Noble Drew Ali. Prophet Noble Drew Ali never said black is death according to science. He said black means death according to science, according to knowledge. According to knowledge, means. So what does the word means mean? What is the signification of the word means? What is the definition of the word means? You're going to look at it and you're going to see that the word means is defined as to signify. To signify. So black signifies death according to science. What science? The nature sciences. Biology. Let's go into biology. When the cellular tissue begins to die, a part of that process is called black putrefaction. You can look this up. Black putrefaction. That is a part of the process when the cellular tissues within the body begins to die. That means that part of those particular portions of the body start to turn black. That is signifying the death of the cellular tissues. You can also see this, and Brother Grimmy R.L. brought this up in a conversation that he and I had. When you study in biology, look at gangrene. Gangrene is when your limbs, the limbs on a part of a body starts to turn black. This is biology, the science of biology. You want to know what science? The science of biology supports this 100%. So when things start to die, human tissue starts to die, it starts to turn black during the decaying process. Part of the process is called black putrefaction. That's what's going on when someone has gangrene. That's what's going on when a person, the body physically dies and begins to decay. Black putrefaction. Okay, so the science of biology. In terms of any other science, the science of mathematics, the science of astronomy, okay? The science of alchemy, all of these different things that the Moors were dealing with in Spain and in West Africa, That's Moorish science. So at the end of the day, in a general sense, when we say Moorish science, we're talking about the same sciences that everybody else thinks comes from Europeans. We're talking the same sciences that everybody else thinks comes from Europeans. These are the sciences that the Moors were dealing with, the science of mathematics. Okay? All of these things, the science of architecture. When you look into Moorish Spain, when you look into West Africa and see these wonderful edifices, you're talking about Moorish science. These are the things that our people left behind. Our Moorish ancestors that all of these people all of a sudden want to deny. Our Moorish ancestors left these things behind because they were great scientists. They were great mathematicians. They were great astrologists. They were great archaeologists. They were all of these things because, believe me, they were already, we have sources to show that they were involved in ancient Egypt and translating glyphs and stuff before the European was doing it. There's books on that.
Ali, you going in tonight, brother. You going in tonight. Man, I'm just sitting back. I'm taking it all in. I'm looking at the chats. Man, and the chats is saying, let me say this. Y'all can go ahead and share this if you want to, but let me read some of the chats. This coming from, first of all, let me hit O'Mill. O'Mill always trying to go in on something. We need to get him right. O'Mill said, but he quoted the quote-unquote white definition of a European. Man, O'Mill.
Wait. The white definition of a European?
Yeah.
Yo, I don't. That's unintelligible. Go to the next one. I don't even know what that is. Go to the next one, man. Not, no disrespect to dude, but maybe he can rewrite that. Whatever the idea is that he's trying to get across, maybe he can rewrite it so that I can understand what he's saying. I don't even understand what he's trying to say.
So here goes another guy. Let me get True, and I'm gonna leave True alone because True trying to get some shine. True say, show us what the Moors invented. He can't be serious.
Show us what the Moors invented?
This guy can't be serious.
The question is not a serious question.
They can't be.
The question is not a serious question. The Moors, what the Moors invented. Man, yo, look, I wish the brother was on because he has the book where he where they list all of these marvelous inventions and creations and so forth that the Moors left in Spain and in West Africa and so forth.
Man, Go ahead, bro.
I mean, there's a whole list of things from the astrolab to you name it.
Man, this guy take a poop every day. Let's keep it 100. I keep it very basic and simple. He take a poop every day. The Moors develop plumbing, man. And stop playing, man.
Stop playing, man. Running water.
That's right.
Like, Grimion, right, go ahead, Grimion. What you?
This guy can't be serious, man.
Nah, that's a joke question, man. That's just that's an egotistical comment. That has nothing to do with it.
More that's just a brother sitting in front of the screen. You know, well, I'm not disrespecting you, brother, man, but you know, that's just a brother that just regardless of what we say, what we do, or whatnot, you know, they're just gonna be antagonists more. But brother want to know what he invented, the only thing I can do is refer to him. To Introduction to African Civilization by John G. Jackson, and you know in that particular book they'll break down everything for him that the Moors did. I mean, you know, we placed universities and colleges of learning, you know, before there was any such thing as a Cambridge in Europe. You know, we were depositing learning in Europe and in Africa, you know, all right. Throughout North Africa. So the only thing I can say to that particular brother is if you don't believe Tahark or Ali Bey or Grimion L, then you know go read brother John G. Jackson.
Man, Stanley Lane Poole lays it out.
Right.
Stanley Lane Poole lays it out. Dr. Ben, this is one of their favorites. And I like using Dr. Ben because for many, many years, they allegedly, apparently, and I say apparently, but not truthfully, but apparently relied on Dr. Ben's scholarship. Just not this part of it. Just not this part. This part they didn't know about. But Dr. Ben himself, even in the video that we played, Brother Tahaka played last week, on the last show that we did, Dr. Ben says that the Moors built the University of Salamanca in Spain. And that particular university was a copy of the university in the Djinni, which was a copy of the Sankore University that the Moors built in Timbuktu. And yes, I said it last show, and I'm going to say it again. All of those were Moorish establishments. If you don't believe that Timbuktu was a Moorish establishment, go do the research on who established Timbuktu, and you will find out that the group of people who established Timbuktu was a subgroup of Moors called the Tuareg.
Islam, Moor, there's also documentation that the Moorish Muslims, Moorish Muslims in West Africa and Timbuktu and things of that nature was doing ocular surgery in the early 1300s. More, this is how adept our people was.
Indeed,
you know, it's funny to me. It's a brother. Say, my man Joy, Mr. Busher, he busts his gun St. Clair. That's what he do. That's his name. That's all I'm saying. Anyway, he says to Arca, the confusion come in when you assume we say black referring to color. It's not. This is so silly.
It's
identifying black culture. Black culture?
See, this is what I'm saying, bro. He just gave you an example of what it is that I already said.
Culture, I can go right to China.
Man,
I can tell you French culture. I can go right to France. I can show you Russian culture, Germany culture. Go right to German culture. Go right to Germany. Where the heck is black culture?
You want me? Can I answer what black
Come
culture
on, my
is?
Brother. Come on with it, brother.
Black culture? Is
yes, sir.
Black culture is the broken family. Not that they want to know. Now, see, we have to do this because if you ask the question, then we need to go into it. But we're going into this honestly. We're not trying to be disrespectful. Black culture is the broken family. Black culture is black men not marrying the women that they impregnate. Black culture is black men leaving and abandoning the children that they make with these women. Black culture is black women putting those men into the welfare, into the child support system. Black culture is black women getting on welfare and not wanting to get off. And I'm not saying white people don't use welfare, and overwhelmingly they use it more than our people. But I'm just telling you, I'm talking about us. We're focusing on us. I don't want to go into what other people are doing wrong, because yes, other people are doing stuff wrong. But you want to know what black culture is. Black culture is the allowing crimes to take place in your community without doing anything about it to stop it. Black culture is a hair-hatted hooligan robbing an 89-year-old woman in a wheelchair up in the Bronx the other day. That's black culture. Okay? Black culture is allowing drug dealers to push drugs all throughout your community without doing anything about it. All around your children.
And black culture is somebody screaming black power for the last 10 or 15 years and haven't built a doggone thing for the children of our future. But staying on the street and screaming black power. Black power, but they haven't built the clinic, they haven't built the daycare, they haven't built the school, heck, they haven't built a bus to take nobody to school, they haven't even built a bus to take nobody to school, they haven't done anything in support of uplifting people except run their mouth.
I want to say this because they ask about Moore's building, where's the schools for our kids? Well, I'll tell you this, one of the brothers in Al-Eastman actually owns a charter school along with his sister.
See,
he actually owns a charter school.
You know what's funny to me? These guys, they don't see Ali's men on the front page of YouTube channels talking about or bragging about what they do. When they see us, we actually teach it. Whether you are Ali's men, whether you are a Moor from brothers, my brothers in Brooklyn, or you one of my brothers in Baltimore, or you one of my brothers from anywhere around the country, which other group of Moors you are, when you see these Moors are teaching. They're not bragging about what they're doing or what they're about to do. But now when we say you're standing up there doing nothing but telling people black power, black yelling, black power, black power, black power, but you ain't building them. Trust me, we got something to stand on. We telling somebody that, listen, you talking all of this black power talk, but true black power people back in the day was politically active, and you're not motivating people to become politically active. You're phony. And we say that because we are politically active.
Let me tell you who gave some of the best examples of black power. We talked about this earlier. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was one of the best embodiments of black power that this country could have seen. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad, one of the greatest examples of black power. Right there. That man right there. Honest to the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
You know what's funny to me how we continue to let people yell this black stuff to us. But if I say something about more science that they're not familiar with, Where's your source? But they have somebody to yell black power to them all day on a video, but never ask them to verify exactly what they're doing to uplift people besides yelling into a camera or talking into a camera and looking for some views. You know, God put out another video about me. Matter of fact, he put two out today. I'm a star, man. I made it. He put two out on me today. I'm big time, man. I'm big time. Man, I arrived, man. They put two out on me today. In one day. Matter of fact, they took the old video and shared it with the monkey guy. The guy that believe we come from monkeys. Man, I'm telling you, I'm big time. But the point that I'm making, I'm the man. But what I'm saying is, they have never asked these guys that are entertaining them, what have they done lately in the community that relates to true uplifting? I'm talking about food in the mouth. I'm talking about clothes on the back. I'm talking about roof over the head. I'm talking about education in the mind, pen and pencil. I'm talking about stuff like that.
They never
ask these guys this, man.
I'm talking about what is the program for reconstructing the black family. What is the program for teaching black men that they need to marry the women that they're getting pregnant?
Right, Islam. And you know, more as a sidebar, you know, we basically, you know, you and I, Ali, we talked about that today. And, you know, that's why, you know, a lot of people do not want to embrace these paths, man. And, you know, you basically come into the temple and whatnot, you meet a sister, you go court, you know, or you supposed to court, and you supposed to pick that sister or pick that brother according to your choosing and marry, you know, and that's supposed to be your partner, if you will, for life. You have family, you raise children, you set them on a solid, you know, foundation of Islamism and discipline, and basically what. You know, and we're not judging everybody, but basically a lot of people in our community do not want to settle down and do those things. They don't want to have a tight-knit, closely held, disciplined racial community, if you will. So they'll be what, quote, and I'm not disrespecting anybody, but they'll call themselves conscious, but they'll basically throw away the discipline form of consciousness. So they'll put yell black power, put the fists up, go to the poetry session, and mack on four or five of the conscious sisters. You know, they don't want that discipline. And, you know, that's what the MSTVA offer. That's basically, you know, with the Nation of Islam. You know, these days in the Nation of Islam, you know, they got singles ministries, couples retreats and stuff, rather, where people go to meet the wives. See, that's culture. Yep. You know, to meet your mate. But let's get back on this whole white thing, because, you know, I just wanted to point out in his book called Questions We All Ask from July 22nd, 1930 by this author named Godfrey de Peruker. And, you know, for all intents and purposes, he basically talked about what you gentlemen just said in regards to the whole color scheme thing. And I'm going to read it. And you know, this brother's given, this is a print. Well, he's not a brother, but he's a European, meaning that he's not an Asiatic Moor or Moorish American. But he's lecturing to his students in esotericism, whereas, you know, I make the idea that I don't agree with everything that Peruker said, but he's a great teacher to his people. And this is what he said. Let me go ahead and read this demonstration. And he says, the Occidentals, however, have a world of good in them. They are in the foreground of the evolutionary progress to date. They are leading the races of mankind on the earth today. But their time will pass. This is what Peruker's saying. He's talking about the European race, and he's saying that their time will pass. And he said, he goes on to say, they are still young, so far as their experience of building a civilization is concerned, because it was our people who was the older races of people in building civilizations on the planet Earth. And Peruker goes on to say, when your forefathers, talking about the Europeans, when your forefathers ran around the forests of the European countries clad in the skins of beasts, wild white men, and then he has in parentheses this. Now check this out, family and listening audience. He says, or pink men, or because you are pink, not white. The Orientals were building lofty and splendid civilizations. They had merely come in ahead of you on the evolutionary pathway. And when your time passes out, the Occident has run its course. Yes, when empire passes from your grip, it will pass elsewhere to other races of men. And don't forget it. And this is what Godfrey Peruker said.
Right. Right.
Man, you know, Brother Brimion, you know the strange part to me, right? Listen to this. Right now, I'm in Chicago, Illinois, you know. And this is the place where the Prophet Noble Drew Ali said, it's our Mecca as Moorish Americans. So every year, we have the Moorish American National Convention.
Sorry, I couldn't make it up there with y'all, Moor.
Islam, you with me, my brother. Both of y'all with me, my brother. You know, we ride out. But my point is this. The brother made a statement. He said, black doesn't mean a color. It means culture. And so we begin to name those negative things that are truly associated with black culture. It's not a stab. It's actually it's the actual fact. But now let me try to... Black culture. This past spring or early summer, they had in Baltimore the African American Festival. We're talking about black culture. I have footage that I haven't uploaded yet. Everybody was cooking the greasy chicken was European. Facts. They had some Jamaicans there, and they was cooking their jerk chicken.
Right.
They had another group of Europeans cooking Mexican food. They had another group of Europeans cooking soul food. They had like macaroni and cheese where they just took and dumped cans of cheese sauce in the macaroni. This was the food. The entertainment was washed up. And I love all my entertainers. They was washed up entertainers that I've never heard of. I may have caught a couple lines of their songs before. Now, then they put one hot entertainer out there. The twerking starts. You follow me? Mm-hmm. Now, this is black culture.
Right.
Now, let's deal with Greek culture. They have a Greek festival. When you go there, you see the Greeks dancing as they once did in their native land. Yeah. I didn't see any African dancing at the African American festival. This is black culture. They don't know African dancing, which we need to learn African dancing that we may pass it on to our children. Not we, because I can't do all that type of stuff. You know what I'm saying. Anyway, you might get shocked at the door or something. You follow me. But nevertheless, you go to the Chinese festival. Brother Sharif goes all the time. You see, they're demonstrating things that their ancient or their ancestors demonstrated. Go to the African American festival in any city. There is nothing that I have witnessed that says that this is a rich, high culture or civilization. Nothing. So when we talk about black culture, we're saying just what we mean. Black, according to science, means death, because these things means death. It points to non-growth. It points to an undeveloped people, an unevolved people. And we're past that. We have to let it go to move to the next level. But guess what? We will not let it go. And we have some people taking the check to teach you not to let it go. Because when you don't let it go, somebody else stays in power. When you don't let it go, those ones that take that cheap check for that S550 and stay up in the hood in that little raggedy apartment shooting their videos, they continue to take your bread.
Right, right. That's right. That's what the prophet said, boy. Prophet Noble Drew Ali told us, he said, if you don't be careful, your own brother will put you back in slavery.
And that's a true statement.
Can I give you another example of how that particular person you mentioned demonstrated black culture over the past handful of years? He set up debate after debate after debate after debate after debate, where each debate was designed to tear down someone else's way of life, someone else's ideology, whatever it is, someone else's belief system, every single thing that that guy has put in place is put in place for the sole purpose of trying to destroy something else.
Absolutely.
It's either the Hebrew Israelites, it's either the Christians, it's either the Muslims. They came after the Nation of Islam. That's Wesley had to shut them down, but they tried it. They tried it. They came after the Moors. They came after the Hebrew Israelites. They come after the Christians. The bottom line is their whole thing, that particular demonstration of quote unquote black culture,
right,
has done nothing but manifest division, hatred, vitriol, venom, everything that harms.
Right.
This is what the prophet talked about, the lower self. The lower self breeds all these things that harm. So all he's done, this guy you're talking about, all he's done was manifest lower self nature. That's
right.
It.
And you know what, Brother Ali Bey and Brother Grimion Hill, my thing is this, man. People need to understand. You don't have to put on a fez or a turban to subscribe to information. Vet the information. Put in your Google search, what does white mean? Start at Wiki.
And they're going to keep saying that that's the white man's. See, so he did it the other way. He said that's the Europeans. That's the European definition.
My point is, start somewhere. Start somewhere. You understand what I'm saying?
Go to your beloved Egyptians. That's why I use the Egyptian piece, because I know how beloved Egyptian is. Egypt is amongst a lot of our people. So it's like you're talking about culture. You're talking about a culture. You're talking about the knowledge base of a group of people and how they saw things. And so the people who are adept at archaeology, the people who are adept in deciphering texts and so forth, this is what they came up with. This is what they was able to come up with based on their experience.
Right.
So right. All we're saying, go ahead, brother. Go ahead, brother.
No, you know, Mo, I just wanted to add, you know, since the show is about whiteness, you know, yes. I wanted to add that when you call the European a white man, just based upon what you are saying, based upon what the Egyptologists researched and all of our research in this particular field and dealing with so-called black and so-called white, you know, I want to convey to our brothers and sisters in the conscious community that when you call the European white, you are giving him too much credit.
That's right.
You are when you call him white, you are basically calling him God. And that's, you know, right. As you know, what I just read and Brother Ali had been reading on this show for a while, is telling you. So, you know, when you say the white man this, the white man that, you know, if you look at his history, you know, with the past 500 or 600 years, all of the stuff he's done is everything else except white. We should be calling him the black man.
That's right.
You know, wherever his civilization went, it brought death, trichnology, or what Prophet Noble Drew Ali called European psychology. I mean, you know, I talk to my wife all the time regarding what they call Japanese animation cartoons. And these are cartoons that originate in the style of them, in the the storylines of them originate in Japan. But then when you look at the cartoon characters, they're all pale, pink, straight feature, blonde hair, superhero characters. The characters don't even look like the Japanese people who originated that genre that they call Japanese anime.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. So, you know, this man has carried death and destruction, you know, with him under the guise and the banner of Christianity. And I'm not speaking radical against any organized group. We're just talking about the history of civilization. You know, this man, brought the original germs that was indigenous to him, went and brought it amongst other populations of people and wiped out entire populations. I mean, even when you come here in the South and the eastern hemisphere of the country, you know, we had all types of earth and mound pyramids all over this land and statues and temples and housing. You can't even find none of those ancient relics today because he raised them to the ground. When you call him white, you might as well call him God, and that's what basically the Moors are saying in that regard, because everything he's done has been black and not white. If white represents the light, if white represents truth, if white represents purity, if it represents God. The Yoruba said that. The Yoruba's dressing white. I think white is the signifying color for their god Obatala, if I'm not mistaken. So, you know, with that being said, you know, brother man, you know, and all of the people listening, when you say you can make a defense for the black, but if you will, but every time, you know, in words, let me say this, I'm gonna say this last thing. Words are spirit. And that's why when you put letters together in a word, they call it a what?
Spelling.
Spelling. So words is power. That's why back in the days the elders used to say, don't say that. Don't say you can't do it. You know, they don't say that. Don't say that negative thing, because when you put this stuff out in the atmosphere, it has a energy to it. It has an effect to it that basically reverberates in the universe. So every time you talk about the white man won't let me through, the white man won't let me pass, the white man won't do this, every time you saying that, all the Asiatics are saying that, basically they're feeding the egregore of the European race. Feeding his powerful, feeding power, I should say, into the energy of his dominancy.
Exactly. Exactly. Mm-hmm. And Grimmy Arnell, and what I was adding, what I was leading to is exactly that was excellent, because on the flip side of the black thing, what I was talking about is not putting down a so-called my brothers, that blood run through their veins as my vein is the same. That's Islam. Not what we're doing here. That's not what we're doing here. We're saying this. What we're saying this is everything as it relates to being black has been negative. You cannot get around it. Ever since the ending of the Civil War, it has been negative. When you look at black history, they take you to the Civil War, when you were hung, when you were sprayed with dogs, and all of these fights that we fought, but it always was being us being defeated in some form or fashion until they gave us some sort of granted privilege. This is what black culture does. Now, I'm here in Chicago, as I was saying. We're talking about culture. We're talking about Moorish culture. I am at a national convention for the Moorish American. It was established in 1929 by the Holy Prophet Noble Drew Ali. Okay, he's not holy to you? Fine. Guess what he did, though? He established a culture centered around us being in America, but descendants from ancient Moabites, Moroccans, Moors. And now today we have a program that every year we come to, and we come to Chicago, we fulfill that program, and it's as equivalent to the Hajj as the Orthodox Muslims, if you will, go to the East. We come to Chicago, which is our Mecca. Now, why do I point that out? Because we're saying that there is no rich culture in the ideology of black. It does not exist. What do you do in black culture? Tell me.
And see, and I'm going to tell you something. Honest. What the great achievements of our people here in this country, because we've had many great achievements and many great advancements in this country, the culture, whether that be our invention of various forms of music like jazz or from jazz all the way to hip hop. These things are uniquely American. They are American cultures. Now, they'll say they're black cultures or black American cultures, but the fact of the matter is they are uniquely American cultures. And we as Americans, based on our experiences, developed these different things here. All right, so our experience is an American experience. We're trying to take the people away from identifying with these different color classifications because of the signification behind them, right? And so that's why we're talking about whiteness. And I really, quite frankly, am tired of going in on blackness, because when we do that, they think that we're coming at, they think that we're coming at what they identify with, because they actually believe that they're really black people. So when we start talking about black and what all it represents, it's offensive to them. So that's why I wanted to do, more on the white thing. And I swear, man, I apologize, because I'm not home in front of my desktop. I only have my laptop. And I did not bring the charger, so the battery is about to die, and I don't have access to everything I wanted to read. But there are a number of sources, dealing with everything from Johann Blumenbach to Carl Linnaeus to the other European, these men who established these color-coded racial constructs and put white at the top of this thing and put black at the bottom, and then place all of the so-called sub-Saharan Negroes into the black classification. It's important that people know this stuff to be able to put it into proper perspective. And I know a lot of times people come back with Bilal al-Sudan. Say, well, what about Bilal al-Sudan? Well, you all that have problems with Arabs and so forth, Sudan, just like Biden, Sudan is an Arabic term that came to the continent by way of the Arabic speakers. So that's not something that the people call themselves. They didn't just call themselves Sudan. And at the root of the word Sudan is the word Sud. The word soot means to denigrate or to blacken. It means to denigrate or to blacken. That's the root of the word Sudan. So now you're coming from people who y'all claim that y'all don't like. Y'all claim that the Arabs did this and that and the third to the Africans and you know all of these different things. So the Arab speakers are calling the place Bilad as-Sudan. And you think that that somehow supports your point about blackness, and it doesn't. That's somebody else saying that about those people. Those people have their own names. They have their own names, and Zulu is not black. All right, so you have over a course of different periods of time, people who was classifying a whole group of people with dark skin as black. And if I mean, look, that's the way they did it. And before that, before the Bilad as-Sudan, you had the Greeks talking about Ethiopia, where they're talking about the people with burnt face. But that had more to do with their perception and their ignorance, thinking that the people were burnt by the sun to the complexions that they are. And that wasn't the case. Because if that was the case, you know, if it had to do with the relation between the people and the sun, we wouldn't be born with the complexions that we are. So there was ignorance. At the same time, Ethiopia or Ethiop was a term that they used for anything that had a dark surface. It didn't even have to be people. Any object with a dark surface could be called Ethiop, because the term op, meaning op, actually has to do with the face of a thing. It has to do with the face of a thing. Not just the eyes, but the face. So the face or the surface of a thing could be considered dark or black or burnt. The Greeks would call it Ethiop. I have a material on that as well. Like I said, unfortunately, I don't have it in front of me. But this is an actual fact. So you have different people over the course of time calling people things that tend to go back to black. And the reason that Ethiop or burnt goes back, is at the root of blackness, is because when you look at the word black and go to the etymological root of the word black in the Proto-Indo-European form, bleg, B-H-L-E-G, you're going to find that black in that particular form is actually a verb. It's not even an adjective. It's not even a description in its earliest form, bleg. It's a verb that's speaking to a process of burning. And it means to burn. It means to burn. So in the earliest form of black is relative to the term Ethiop, which means burnt face. So at the end of the day, you got people either telling you that you're black because you were burnt to that complexion, or you're black based on some kind of degeneration or denigration as you are on the totem pole of human civilization. You're at the lowest totem pole. So when you, if for instance, if you look at the 1911 Dictionary of Races and Peoples, you're not even going to find the definition of black in that dictionary. It's called the 1911 Dictionary of Races and Peoples, or Races or People. When you look up the word black in that dictionary, it has no definition. It tells you to see Negro. So you have to turn to the end section to go to the term, to the word Negro. And one of the things that they say about Negro is that the Negro is the lowest man or the lowest species in the human civilization that comes from so-called sub-Saharan Africa. And this low species, who they're saying is the lowest species, or the lowest form of species in terms of a human, is the ancestor to the people called Negroes in the United States or African Americans. So when they're telling you you're black because Negro is nothing more than the Spanish or Portuguese articulation of the English Germanic word black. So when they're telling you that you're black, they're really telling you that you are a Negro who is a descendant of this low species from the sub-Saharan Africa. And this has nothing to do with genetics, because the 1911 dictionary was put out in 1911, long before any Europeans were doing any DNA sequencing. So the fact that they're telling everybody who's of who they consider African Americans or blacks, the fact that they're telling everybody that they descend from sub-Saharan Africa, they had already made up their mind before they started making these DNA tests that you came from the sub-Saharan Africa. You can find this in 1911 in the Dictionary of Races of Peoples. So they really didn't even need DNA sequencing to tell you that you were sub-Saharan African. They had already made up their minds about this.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Mo, if I could interject real quick, because it just came to my mind. And we're not the only ones that are saying this. I know we talking about the word white, but I have to add, you know, because we didn't talk about it on the show, that when we talked about black. But there's a book. And this book is written by a brother, an Asiatic man, a Moor. The name of the book is The Name Negro, Its Evil Origin and Evil Use, by Richard B. Moor.
That's right.
And if you don't believe, and Noble Drew Ali was saying this stuff way before Richard B. Moor wrote this particular book. So we can't say it's biased. You can't say that the man was unduly influenced by the Morris Science Temple of America or whatever conspiracy theories that you could have out there. And I just wanted to read, if I can, an excerpt, excuse me, out of the book. And this is page 33, The Social Origin of the Name Negro. And the brother says, at the outset, it would be best if I state how I became convinced that the name, that a change in this name Negro was necessary. I had discussed this matter time and again with several people because opposition to the name Negro has never ceased among people of African descent in this country. As we shall see, this name has never fully been accepted. Some years back, I think it was in the 1920s, when Dr. J. Edmondson Barnes, who had recently come from London, delivered a lecture at the People's Educational Forum, then held in Lafayette Hall in New York City. In the course of his remarks, Dr. Barnes said, "The name Negro is a bastard political colloquialism which ought to be rejected," close quote. Now, with that being said, I'm just going to flip over to, you know, for all of our Moore haters that we have. And it's really unfortunate because, you know, nobody can point out what we are saying and how it is derogatory towards the race. We talked about the greatness of our race, the greatness of our people. The brother Larry was talking about how everything came from the pale Arabs. And we saying, no, we were the ones that did that. So we are touting the greatness of our race, touting the greatness of Africa. The only problem, and I'm looking at the chat, this chat group, and the only problem that the people are having is that we don't want to accept the label that those people put on us. And with that being said, in the same book on page 36, it's the subtitle on that page is the first known use of quote unquote Negroes as a name for slaves. And Mr. Moore goes on to say, however, the first use of the word Negro as a noun or name, and the reason I'm pointing out Negro, because Negro is nothing more than the Spanish, is than Spanish for the word black. Now, I'll continue reading. The brother goes on to say, however, the first use of the word Negro as a noun or name in relation to African people is to be traced back to the period after 1441. When the Portuguese explorers went down the African coast until they reached below the Senegal River. They had referred to the people above that river as Moors. But when they saw the people south of the Senegal,
who were of much darker hue and whose weapons were much less powerful than their crossbows and firearms, the Portuguese perceived the possibility of easy conquest and a lucrative slave trade. They began enslaving, they began to enslave the African people. So I'm just pointing out the scholarship, you know, behind all of this stuff that's taking place in regards to these terminologies of black and white. We're not the only ones saying this. This stuff is heavily documented in the history of sociology, political science, all the different types of sciences that you can imagine, like what Brother Ali Bey was saying. Peace.
Islam, Brother Mati was good.
Islam, boys.
You wanted to add on?
Well, I mean, I was listening in. You know, I know I'm late chiming in, but first of all, you know, of course, I have to rise and give all praises to Allah and honor to His Holy Prophet, Noble Jarrah Ali. But and honors to you, brothers, man, y'all been holding it down here tonight, and what Brother Zach just said is right on point. You know, but let's get back to the issue at hand here, which is whiteness, because we always end up defending our, you know, our Moorishness against blackness, you know. But let's get back to whiteness for a minute, because if we get back to whiteness, then we got to deal with who gave us this terminology that we so heavily defend, whether we're defending, you know, the right to be black, which somebody else gave you, or we're defending, you know, the fact that that we refer to them as white. Now, it's already been said, you know, so I don't really need to say it again, but we know that the word white does not refer to a people at all. It refers to no ethnicity. It refers to no race of people. It refers to no national identity. So why do you call this man white? When we know that the very definition of white means purity, godly, and as a prophecy of the ruler of the land. Well, I mean, if we think about it, you know, let's look at it from, say, a semi-legal perspective. You know, when we're talking about black and white, and we think about the preamble of the Constitution, it says that, it teaches us that, you know, as a people, you know, we're endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights. You know, well, if you're endowed by your Creator with certain inalienable rights and somebody else created the whole black and white psychology, then what does that tell you? And that tells you that the same man that you look at, that you demonize, the one whose very language that you repeat, you're calling him your God. And it's right there in the Constitution, because the European is the creator of Negroes, the creator of so-called black people, the creator of so-called colored people. So if he is your creator, then I guess he is your God. So I guess you will run around calling him a white man all day. But again, that ties him to no land. That ties him to no region on this earth. It is not the tone of his skin. Why don't you ask yourself intelligently, why do I call this man white? Why? I mean, what is my reason? It's because he told you to call him that.
Right.
And the prophet said that these are nicknames. He said you running around here with a nickname. The rest of the world running around here with national identity. The rest of the world running around here talking to each other civilized with nationalities. I mean, because he'll tell you he's a white man, but he can tell you also that he's from Ireland. He can tell you also that he's from Scotland. He's from Germany. You know, he can tell you exactly what country he comes from. He can show you his coat of arms. He can show you his lineage all the way back. You know, he can trace himself. One thing you can say, we were kings and queens in Africa.
Yeah, everybody was not. But go ahead, bro.
Yeah, I mean, and here's the joke. You know, most of us in Africa were common people.
Of course.
I mean, we like to sell this fantasy that we were kings and queens in Africa. Kings and queens don't get sold into slavery. Particularly by their own people. So see, you have to understand that Africa, as well as Europe, recognize nationalities. Everybody wasn't walking around talking about I'm black, I'm black, you black, I'm black.
Or I'm African.
Right. Oh, I'm African, you African, I'm African. No, these are the nationalities, these are nations, you know, and these nations fought with each other. They traded with each other. You know, they interacted as nations do. You know, sometimes nations behave badly. So we have to stop romanticizing about a fake history that didn't exist. And it was so great until the so-called white man came. Again, back with that terminology, white man.
Mm-hmm.
So again, you're back to referring to him as God. We're so tied to that. We're so tied down to this whole white and black psychology. And you're asking what science is it? Can't you see the social science in that? It's a mean psychology. You can't see that? What science is it? Brother, it's the science of washing your brain clean. Of removing any sense of self and self-worth from you. Of giving you a name and you wanting to be somebody so badly that you even take the worst name that anybody could possibly give you and try to turn it around and defend it. Defend it to the death. Be ready to hurt us because we're trying to tell you your real name. And it's the last name that you will call. And there's absolutely actual fact and proof and documented evidence. But you want to dismiss the evidence because you want to hold to this theory of blackness. You know, and so what if black is, you know, the origin of the universe and all that? That has nothing to do with your race. It has nothing to do with your nationality. It has nothing to do with your ethnicity. Do you even know the difference between the three? I mean, because so many times when we're talking, we're so busy interchanging, you know, race and ethnicity and nationality, you know, all in one sentence.
Mm-hmm.
You don't even know what you're defending, but you're asking what science are we dealing with?
Right. And then not even being specific as to what particular topic, you know, there's different things that is governed by different laws of different sciences, man. And so these are general questions that are coming from non-genuine places, because most of the people asking questions, oftentimes they don't really want to know. They're just looking for a way into initiating an actual argument as opposed to trying to understand what you're really saying or where you're really coming from. You know, my bad, bro. You can finish.
Nah, boy, you're on point. You're absolutely on point. And that's why, you know, I just got quiet and started listening. But, you know, we also, you know, we deal with our own with this nonsense and this madness. You know, we got Moors who run around here identifying themselves as white men.
Right. I'm glad you brought that up.
Let's deal with that, Moors. Yes, sir. Let's deal with that.
Before we close out, excuse me, brother. Hey, brother Matty, brother. Yes, sir. you really did it big with that right there. You know, because as Brother Ali Bates said, and you as well as Remy R.L. say, you know, we don't want to shift right back to the black thing. Let's deal with this white thing. And we were talking about as it relates to your opinion. But that topic right there needs to be addressed also, where we as Moorish Americans think that, okay, since white mean purity, purity mean God, and God mean rule of the land, I'm a white man now. Now, how does that relate to a Moorish American Muslim? Let's deal with that. Anybody can grab that. Thank you, brother, for bringing that topic up before we close up. Praise Allah.
Well, I would say this. I would say that it's foolish. And the reason that it's foolish is because when you're talking about social classifications, which, quote unquote, free white person, was a legal status pertaining to naturalization back in the 1700s. I think it was the late 1790s or something. When they had this particular free white person status that, you know, these Moors are running around claiming to be free white person. But it was a status for foreign people. People meaning, and when I say foreigners, I don't mean somebody living here pretending that they're not under the jurisdiction. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about foreigners from other countries who were seeking citizenship in the United States. and the United States Europeans created a status called free white persons for those people, for certain people who were trying to seek who wanted to gain citizenship in the United States. Some of it included certain pale skin, or what they would probably call Tanny or Tony Moors from Africa. That did not, listen, that did not have to do with people born in the United States. The people born in the United States were either citizens already, or they were enslaved. That was their status. Either you're already a citizen, which we know from historical records that there were quote unquote Negroes or blacks who were citizens at the time of the adoption and ratification of the Constitution.
Right.
And then there were those who were enslaved, just like there were white slaves at damn near the end of this, look, I think it was the 1860 census. The 1860 census. I posted this in the Ali's Men group. Under the 1860 census, they had a slave schedule where the slave schedule lists nothing but white people as slaves in the federal census. White people. And they were listed as white in the slave schedule as property. So all I'm saying is that these people have twisted up a lot of things for our people, and the like I said before, and I think on the last show or the show before that, the slave narrative that has been given to us is in a lot of areas very faulty. But in terms of the white status, it has become a social classification. It's not a legal status. That's what I was saying on the last show. It's not a legal status. It may have been at a certain point in time, just like the black thing may have been at a certain point in time. But at this point in time, where we are in this point in history in this country, those are racial classifications that are social. They're not legal. So there's no legal ramification for not identifying as black. There's no law that says that anybody has to identify as black, anybody has to identify as white. There's nothing that says you have to do that on federal census records. When the census comes around, you don't have to tell them that you're black. You don't have to tell them that you're white. There's no law holding you to any of that. But people are doing it, they're perpetuating it on their own. But in terms of Moors claiming to be free white persons, that's a status that used to exist for the purpose of naturalization, for people who were trying to seek citizenship in the United States. Had nothing to do with people who were already living here, either as citizens or as enslaved people. Had nothing to do with them. And it has nothing to do with us today. That status doesn't even exist anymore.
Islam. I like to add real quickly, you know, number one, you know, because this is the problem, Moore. A lot of people like to confound the teachings of the Moorish Science Temple of America with other different groups of Moorish Americans that may be outside the Moorish Science Temple of America who say, you know, ignorantly that they are free white men. But as far as myself, and I can't speak for every member of the Moorish Science Temple of America, but all true members of the Moorish Science Temple of America would tell you that that is not a teaching of Noble Drew Ali for Moorish Americans to call themselves free white men. You'll find it nowhere in our teachings. That's right. Those come from a sovereign citizen, Moors, if you will, and no disrespect to those brothers, but they tried to do that to bolster their other sovereign citizen claims to act lawless and to act recklessly, you know, before the citizens in of this particular government that we refer to as the United States of America. But you won't find that anywhere in our teachings of us calling ourselves free white men. You know, those guys want to get out of traffic tickets and don't want to drive without driver's license. So they try to use those free white men classifications, if you will, to get out of that stuff. They're reaching for straws.
Right. And even with that, you know, when we really consider that information didn't really come about until the 1700s, you know, we can clearly see that even that's made up by the European. It was made up as a particular status and given by the European as a so-called legal status. It's not even really a legal status anymore. Again, like Brother Grimion Hill just said, you'll find that nowhere in any of the prophet's writings. You'll find that nowhere in any of our formal teachings. You'll find that nowhere. You won't find that in the Moorish Guide newspapers. You won't find that that as an article that the prophet quoted from. You won't find that anywhere in Obadiah's teachings. Now, if you want to find that, you got to go see the Black's Law Dictionary, Moors. You can't come to the Moorish Science Temple of America and expect to find it.
And it's actually the 18th. Let me see where this act with free white persons. Free white persons referred to in Naturalization Act as amended by Act July 14th, 1870, has meaning naturally given to it when first used in Volume 1 of the Statutes at Large, page 103, meaning all persons belonging to the European races, then commonly counted as quote-unquote white, and their descendants, including such descendants in other countries to which they have immigrated. And then they give a list of different people. But one of the things they talk about, it includes the Magyars, the Laps and Finns, and the Basque and Albanians. It includes the mixed Latin, Celtic, Iberian, and Moorish inhabitants of Spain and Portugal. Then it says the mixed Greek, Latin, Phoenician, and North African inhabitants of Sicily, and the mixed Slav and Tatar inhabitants of South Russia. So what they're looking at is when it's talking about Moorish inhabitants, but they're talking about mixed Moorish inhabitants and mixed Phoenicians, right? So they're not even talking about pure people, okay? They're talking about these people that had came to be known as Tawny and Tanny Moors and stuff like that.
Brother, that's simply a case of what we call grave robbing, brother. All they're doing is trying to use a made-up status that they made up in the 1800s to steal our birthrights and steal our nationality, the same as they did with Egypt. That's why that brother who somebody referred to in the chat, when he came here from Egypt, you know, he was fighting for the right to be called black. I mean, you know, first of all, he's a civilized person. He should be fighting for the right to be called an Egyptian. But he was fighting for the right to be called black, but they weren't allowed because he came from Egypt. And so they wanted to steal the birthright. So, of course, Egypt is included in that type of thing as far as free white person. Even as late as the 1920s, you know, is when they adopted the Asians. You know, they started, you know, accepting, you know, the Chinese and the Japanese as white people. They started giving them that legal designation, you know, around that time, around the 1920s. Prior to that, you know, they didn't consider them as white. So they didn't have any rights either. You know, they were a subgroup here in the United States as well. You know, so I mean, it's all, you know, this whole color code scheme is what it is. It's a scheme. You know, this whole color code scheme is nothing but something to steal birthrights and steal the traditions, steal the histories of great people, and we allow it playing into the game. You know, and this is why I was just looking at to get those nicknames back.
Exactly, bro. I was just looking at the Naturalization Act of 1790, and it talk about in the 1790 Naturalization Act, the law limited naturalization of immigrants to who were free white persons, right? And but the bottom line to all of it, 1790 up to 1870 naturalization, the key term to understand is naturalization. And when they're listing all of these different peoples who fell under the classification that they created, these same European devils created this free white person classification for naturalization in the United States, they are talking about people who are foreigners to the United States. They're not talking about people who are inhabitants here, people who were citizens here, people who were enslaved here, had nothing to do with anybody, even if they were calling themselves Moors here, had nothing to do with them. This had to do with people from the outside of the country who were being classified as free white persons by the Europeans in this country.
That's right. That's right.
So these Moors that are talking about that stuff, man, they don't know what they're talking about, man. You're not going to find in any body of law in the United States right now, there's no United States law that has anything about a free white person in it today. The status, no law, it doesn't exist. Doesn't exist. Now, what they talk about is they'll say that white people, now you can go on Federal Directive 15 and you'll see a white person, it'll say includes the original peoples of North Africa. But who is that? Who are the original people of North Africa?
Grave robbing, brother. Grave robbing.
You know what I mean? So that, and you know, that has nothing to do with naturalization anymore either. So that part of the naturalization law doesn't exist.
You know what, brother? As we wrap this up and bring this to a close, right? My thing is this, you know, I used to, back in the day, I'm a little bit tired, but I did some traveling. I came all the way to Mecca. But back in the day, right, I tried some things, you know what I mean? Tried some things, get me a few coins, right? Get me a couple coins. But every time I tried these things, I found myself getting caught up. You follow me? So one day I was like, man, ain't no right way to do wrong. So let me try something else. You know, I tried the prophet. Everything went great and continues to go great. What has black gotten us in the true sense? What have we received from being black? And that's a rhetorical question for those who subscribe and hold on to black. Now, the topic of the show is, what does white really mean? And as my brother Ali says, hard not to speak of black. Even when we're talking about the topic of the show, what does white really mean? What white really means is that you have put somebody above you. You have consented to somebody being above you. When you call them something, let me tell you something about the psyche. This is my expertise right here. You know, we got scholars, we got historians, we got all of these philosophical type people within the Moorish paradigm. My specialty is this, how the mind works. The mind knows our forefathers have created the color code system as it relates to white meaning purity, green meaning life, red meaning passion, black meaning death, these type of color codes. Our forefathers created this. Now, because our forefathers created this, within our psyche, we know what it means, what we will call the soul. Within our soul knows what these things mean. So every time that you call a European, quote unquote, white, you confirm your inferiority to yourself. That's why it's so hard to pull yourself together, because you beat yourself down psychologically without you even knowing it. That's why our sisters, they put extensions and glue hair to their baby girl's hair, because by default, not calling themselves black, but by default, as they call that European white, they have belittled themselves, and by default, they will continue to burn their hair. By default, they will continue to mimic and imitate the European. By default, because they put the European there every time they confirm in their mind that this European is white and that they are black, but the topic is white, that they confirm that this European is white. They have belittled themselves, and now they must try to reach the equivalent of being white. And so what do? They destroy themselves. They become the little Kims of today. They become the Michael Jacksons of yesterday. They become all of these fictitious characters, just to try to measure up to what they think white is, and the European not even white. So any final words in closing, my brothers, as we close up?
Islam. Brother, you just gave a beautiful lesson on the social sciences, brother. It's all sociology and psychology. These are the sciences that we're dealing with. You know, when we're talking about the color code scheme, and it was a scientific experiment, you know, used against our people, you know, to denigrate us and to show that whiteness is the standard for everything, and then to paint themselves as the so-called standard of whiteness. So now, like you said, our people, you know, strive to be as European as possible. You know, we look at European concepts of beauty. You know, we look at the European concept of history. You know, all the prophets, all the great men of renown. Even if they're in Africa, you know, we've given European images of them. So now we believe that all, you know, even in our psyche, in our mind, you know, most of the times when you think about the name Jesus, immediately that European image pops in your head, and you have to actually turn it off. You know, so it was a mean psychological game that was played on us. You know, it came to a people, you know, who were psychologically dead to bring us life. So I just want to say in closing, you know, that white means purity. I these people are not pure. Stop calling them.
Peace. Anybody else?
Islam,
my brother.
After this demonstration, I really ain't have nothing more to say. I just wanted to tell you more, tell them more that I say Islam up there.
Islam. The
Supreme Grand Governor and all of them brothers, man, tell them just tell him, man, I love him, man, and I wish I could be in Chicago, man. I miss Chicago.
Islam. How about you, Ali Bey? Because I'm going to close out with a few words.
Okay. Yeah, Islam. Now, I think pretty much we covered as much. I tried to do as much as I could from the top of the head, man. I really wanted to read from some things, but maybe we'll touch on the subject at a later time on a different show, so we can go more into it in terms of the historical creation of or the invention of the white race and the reasons surrounding this invention, why it happened, you know, and the purpose for it. Is there was a purpose for it, not just, you know, in terms of creating a hierarchical racial class or classification or caste system in the United States, but there was a reason for it, and a lot of it had to do with labor and the clashes that were taking place between Europeans and the Africans in terms of labor and who was going to dominate in the labor and dominate the labor force, particularly as time moved on through slavery and then even going into, you know, coming after slavery and so forth. So it has a purpose, and it has a lot to do with, you know, it had a lot to do with labor. So, but we can go into that at another time, bro. And I just want to say peace. I'm glad we have this platform to go into different things and to just build, and hopefully, you know, more and more people will listen as we go, and we can start to clarify a lot of things that have been confusing for people. Like this free white persons thing and so forth, bro. But I'll say peace, bro.
Peace. And before we close out, I'd like to just say, you know, the Moorish Science Temple of America, it's culture in there. It's a rich culture in there. And when we say we Moorish American, we're saying we of the Moors and we in America. That's why you may see a Moor and not even know that he's a Moor. He might not have on his fez every day, but his character will display that Moorish culture in America, without a doubt. With that being said, I want to say this. If you see that these brothers on the other side, and I call them brothers on the other side, you know, are continuing to be antagonistic and not working towards to build something. I know you like to be entertained. Heck, I do too. But sometimes when you allow yourself to be entertained, you actually validate this nonsense. You know, this broad man guy, I ain't gonna say none of their names. But you know, this broadman guy really thinks he's intelligent. He's a Wikipedia scholar. These people think this guy is intelligent. He's a Wikipedia scholar. He made a statement that I have been locked up 20 years. I studied for 20 years. I didn't ride, I didn't play around. I didn't play games. I studied for 20 years when I was incarcerated. That means he never read any revision books. And the books he read was not revised. They were the same old story for 20 years. Trust me on this one. His information did not evolve. That's why he says there's never been such a thing as ancient Mauritania in the land where Morocco is. Of course he's going to say that, because that old book that he had said that. Of course. You know, and we hold this up to being scholarly. Then we got the drunk guy that when I went up to 125th and I was on that camera and that brother was next to me, smelled like a liquor store. Yet he gonna teach the children. And then he pulls up two students while he telling everything. I said, what you doing for the people? What you doing for the people? He said, here are my students here. When we turn to look at his students, they rolling up an L. Are you kidding me?
Yeah, right.
Here's my response right here. I'm not wasting my time. I'm in Mecca on a journey right now, and I'm being next to some brothers and sisters that are clearing their heart and mind, ready to feel the truth, which the spirit of the prophet Noble Drew Ali can, so the spirit of the prophet Noble Drew Ali can enter. And here these guys is running around putting out videos about the Heart of Bay. I love it, brother. Keep it going. I love the publicity. Keep it going, brother, because the more people you talk about, the more people that you talk to about me, they're going to come in here to Hawker Bay, and they're going to get snagged away from your nonsense because you've been fleecing the people too long. You've been taking their money too long, brother. You say, okay, I've been doing this for free one time because you ain't know how to make money at one time. But now you figured it out. Now you figured it out that you can keep on talking this craziness and people will pay to see it. But check it out. I know your ticket sales went down at the Dr. Sebi demonstration. I seen the crowd, brother. Yeah, I know it went down. Yeah, okay, you got another one coming up. They going to dwindle too. So keep on coming, brother. You digging your own grave. I ain't got to do nothing. Boy, you played out. It's over for you. Done deal, clown. That's just what it is. Because I ain't playing with y'all no more. The next show, I'm going in by myself. No Ali's, man. Nobody. I'm going in. I'm exposing all y'all. Oh, you ain't from Baltimore. Nobody know you. Nobody know you. Boy, I'm going in your hood with the camera. That's where I'm going at. I'm going to ask them young trappers about you. Now. And then I'm going to find out why you left Boston, boy. Stop playing with me, boy. My bad. Peace and love, family. But hey. I'm going to leave it at that, man. You know, these brothers just keep on playing, man. They're not uplifting our people, man. They're not uplifting our people. They got people believing that they're doing something in the name of uplifting our people, man. They entertain our people no different than Love and Hip-Hop. Clowns. Period, right. Point blank. You know what I mean? I'm going to send y'all into hiding, just like Shaka is right now. I'm going to send y'all all into hiding. But I know the one that's going to keep on coming back. He going to keep on coming back. Because guess why? That's the only thing he know. You take that camera from him. You take that YouTube password from him. You take all that from him. He'd be broke, homie, homeless, and destitute. Period, point blank. And that's just what it is. That's just what it is. You know what I mean? At least Shaka can be a bodyguard and dance and, you know, do that little funny dance. You know what I'm saying? At least he can do that. At least the other one that like to drink, he can sell tickets at the comedy show. You know, he can do that. He wasn't too good at it, but he can give it a shot. You know what I'm saying?
Yo, why that European dude called him a bird, though, man?
And he laughed at it like they would call, oh, my goodness, why would I touch something like that? I'm going to leave it alone, man, because he's still my brother, man. And he laughed at it like it was funny. Like a buffoon. Come on, man. This is ridiculous, man. And I supposed to address that? Y'all for real? Man, anyway, we're going to close off with that. I'm in Chicago, and anybody in Chicago, reach out to me. Let's get together. Let's take a unity picture. Like Side Matter. Let's take a unity picture. Chi-town, you know what I mean? But nevertheless, I'm in Chicago at the Morris National Convention. I'm going to be going live on Facebook, showing y'all what's going on. We're going to enjoy ourselves here, and I'm going to share some pictures with everybody. Hopefully, you're friends with me on Facebook so you can partake of the pictures as well as the live stream videos I do. I don't think I'll be able to do a live stream on Sunday due to the fact I may be in a meeting, because the conventions consist of a lot of meetings. So I may be in a meeting. If I'm not in a meeting, we will do the live stream and then and just have a conversation with those in the crowd. So when we have the conversation with those in the crowd, we'll just have a answer question session, and any Ali's men that's available to come on, we'll bring them on. We'll answer some questions. So people, get your questions together. It doesn't matter what it is, and let's see if we can have an answer and question segment on Sunday. That's if not in a meeting. Yes, sir.
Can I reiterate a couple of things?
Sure.
Just about white.
Absolutely.
The white race is an invention. It's an invention of the European male's mind. Free white person is an invention. It's an invention of the European male's mind. It doesn't matter what they say it includes. I don't care whether they say it includes North Africans. I don't care whether they say it includes Moors. I don't care whether they say it includes Phoenicians who are really Canaanites. I don't care who they say it includes. It is a creation of the European male's mind. And Moors are Moors. Canaanites are Canaanites. Phoenicians are Phoenicians. Okay? Europeans are Europeans. Teutons are Teutons. This whole white person thing, white race thing, is an invention of the European male's mind. Period, point blank. Any Moor that's telling anybody that he's a free white person has subscribed to white supremacy. I don't care how he tries to justify it. Any Moor that tells somebody that he is a free white person based on the definition of free white person in the Naturalization Acts has subscribed to the system of white supremacy.
That's right.
That's it. That's it in a nutshell. You know, brother, I talk to y'all soon, brother. I'm going to ace it out, brother. I've been on the road. I had to meet with the Supreme Grand Sheikh of our Grand Body today. It was beautiful. I'll let y'all go over some of the footage at a later date, brother. I'm tired. Peace, everybody. I want y'all to have a good night, and I will see y'all on Sunday. Peace, Islam. Peace. Love y'all, family. Let's keep it moving and build one love up.
Peace, love.
Peace.
Get some rest, man.
Slide.